You have a Bible with you, Romans chapter 9, if you would open up to there to start with, please. I want to thank you for praying for us while we were taking a week of vacation. Somebody has asked me, I've had several asked, was it good? It was too hot. I'm sorry. It wasn't much of a vacation in my book, 100 degrees, 4 or 5 days in a row. Anyway, we did have air conditioning, even though it did go out one time. And so, whatever. But we thank the Lord for the time off. If you've been with us for the last couple of months, we've been trying to do a study out of the book of Romans. And if you can remember back a couple of months ago, we started off by actually looking in Romans chapter 8 and studying that wonderful chapter, and then went back to see how Paul got to that point. And now we're catching up, and I want us to read a verse of Scripture, or maybe three verses in Romans 9, one in Romans 10, and one in Romans 11, to show you the point to which we have gotten in the life of the Apostle Paul. Romans chapter 9, beginning with verse 1. I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. Now those three verses is Paul's letting us see a glimpse into his heart. Chapter 10, verse 1, if you would please. Chapter 10 and verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Now chapter 11, one verse of Scripture in chapter 11, verse 14. If by any means I may provoke to emulsion them which are my flesh, and might save some of them. Let's bow for prayer together. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for these views into the heart of the Apostle Paul and his concerns. Thank you for his teaching that you gave to him to give to us. May we learn from you, Lord, in such a way that it might apply to our lives and we might serve you as the victorious Christians that we are supposed to be. Please, Lord, for your glory, your honor, and then we know it'll be for our good. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Before I get started, I got a feeling that most of you are about like I am. You're about sick and tired of all the news, politics, terrorism, all this junk. But I want y'all to understand something. You're not seeing what's really happening. If you try to go behind the scenes, read up on some of the places that's willing to deal with the martyrs and that which is happening to Christians overseas. I learned Friday that there was, I don't want to mess up with the numbers. I think it was 13 girls who were 17 years old. And they tried to make them slaves to some of the ISIS men, and they refused. And they put them all in a cage and set them on fire and killed them. We don't hear about that stuff. That's not news. That's not politically acceptable. But what I want you to understand by saying that and bringing that up is this. I don't think we've got a stinking clue as how bad we are. I don't think we got a clue. Do you understand Jesus warned us from end to end? We are to be soldiers in the army of God. We're to be ready to stand up for that which is right, knowing we will suffer too. Jesus Christ did not promise to any of us a bed of roses filled with love and kindness and sweetness in this world. He promised us suffering and sorrow if we follow him. That's a negative way to start off what I'm wanting to share this morning, but I just felt like I had to. I've heard it, I don't know how many times already this weekend and elsewhere. Tired of the news, tired of the politics, tired of all the stories of the terrorism around the world and at home here. We're tired of it. Yeah? But when we get tired enough and you finally had enough, Then it'll be time to stand up and be Christians. Real Christians. It's coming, folks. It's coming. Now, we just read these scriptures here in Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11, and it's the Apostle Paul. And he's showing us finally where his heart is. His heart is that he loves his kinfolk, his brethren, the Jews. He loves them and cares about them. And he hopes that they'll get saved. And in particular there in that where we started off and read those verses in chapter 9, he even implies that he is willing to be accursed from Jesus, that is, lose his salvation. He is willing to go that far if the Jewish nation people, his brethren, would start getting saved. Now, we're getting to a place where Paul is being powerful and strong in his sharing. Now, let me remind you of some things here. I need to bring us all up and make sure we're on the same page here. If you've been following with us as we've been going through this book of Romans, we saw in the first four chapters of Romans how we're all sinners. There is no exception to that. You're a sinner, friend. You are a sinner. And until you get your sins washed in the blood of the Lamb and get born again, you are headed for a lake of fire. That's the teachings of God, and that's the way it is. And at the first four chapters in this particular book of Romans, Paul dealt very heavily with pointing out that we're sinners and all the different things. And in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then he got into chapters 5, 6, and 7, and he overwhelmingly showed us that the grace of God is powerful. The grace of God is real. And God's grace is so powerful, it can overcome and do away with the sin that we're all guilty of. And now that's where we can come to say, take a breather, take a relief. Say, thank you, God. We are sinners, but God has dealt with our sin. He's provided a way for our sin to be washed away in the blood of the Lamb. And the teachings are there in chapters 5, 6, and 7, and how that we can be saved through Christ, and that even though we're such terrible sinners, our sins have been washed away by Christ. And then we came to chapter 8 in this book, and if you were with us, we actually started there just to look at a glimpse of the good things that Paul had to say concerning what God has done for us, and we listed them there in the bulletin this morning. We've been given a new position. We are in Christ. We have been given a new guest. God's Holy Spirit is in us. We have been given a new family. We have been adopted into the family of God. We have been given a new expectation. We can actually expect and look forward to the second coming of Jesus. It's okay to expect that to happen. We can look forward to that. Jesus is coming again. We also see we have been given a helper, a prayer helper in Romans 8:26, where it says that the Holy Spirit is in us to pray for us and with us when we have those groanings inside and we don't even know how to pray and what to pray for. And God's Holy Spirit is our prayer helper. We've been given a new knowledge. Whenever he talked about, for we know that all things work together for good to those that love God. So we've been given something, and I love it whenever these Apostle Pauls and others are willing to make declarations that, you know, it's affirmations of assurance. We know. Not, well, I think so. Well, you know, my opinion is. I'm sorry. If that's where you want to go, just have your opinion, have a hope so, maybe so, might be so. I'm sorry. I'm not going to walk down that road with you. God's word is emphatic. God's word is absolute. And yes, I've had folks tell me before that they didn't think I ought to use the word absolute. Nothing's absolute. We're like politicians. Well, the politicians say, well, I'm absolutely sure the future lies ahead. Yeah. Another one said, well, I'm absolutely sure there's nothing faster than the speed of light, I think. Yeah. All that. No, I'm not going there. I'm not a politician. Praise God. I'm just a born-again preacher of the word. And I'm here to tell you there are absolutes. We are absolutely saved, if we're saved, by grace. The grace of God. And here Paul gets into all this and he deals with these absolutes and these no-sos and everything. But he also, and I'm going through this in this list of things that's in Romans 8. Not only can we know things, but it said we are to have a new goal. You and I should have a new desire, something to strive for, and that is to be like Jesus. That should be your goal, friend, to be like Jesus and do the things he would have us to do. And we do this with a new confidence. And the Apostle Paul, in closing out Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39, he wound up making a declaration, who can be against us? If God is for us, who dares to be against us? And we take that and then go into all that. What can separate us from the love of Christ? And he goes into that wonderful listing there in the end of Romans chapter 8. Now, we've got to that point. So you see what Paul has done is showed us we're terrible sinners, showed us the power of the grace of God, showed us how we can be saved and know we're saved and have these wonderful gifts that come from God. But now it's like he's changing course and he's beginning to show us some things of his own heart, and he's letting us know here. Now, I, even though I know all these wonderful truths that I've shared with you already, I have a heavy heart. And he mentions that, and he says in that verse 2 in Romans 9, he said, "For I have a great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart." A heavy heart. You dare to imagine that he would be willing to actually go to hell instead of heaven so that other folks would get saved? I'm going to be honest with you. Wow. That's beyond Darryl Quinn. That's beyond me. I think I have a reasonable amount of Christian love in my heart for all y'all, the family of God here. I really do. I don't think I'm going to go to hell for you, though, friend. Sorry. That's a great love that Paul had. Great concern. Wow. Hallelujah. But now, you know, what we are so seeing in this, though, in a story that we shared just a couple of months ago, in Abraham and Isaac, and that powerful Old Testament story, and how that when we see Abraham take his son Isaac up that hill, and he binds him, and he puts him on that altar that he made, and he then raises that knife up, and he's fixing to kill his son, and God calls out to him, "Abraham, Abraham, lay not thine hand upon the lad. For now I know thou fearest God." And that's a powerful story. Man, it's one of the best in the Bible, in my opinion. But here's what I want you to understand, and don't forget this, and we said it 3 or 4 weeks ago. That shows you how much God loves you, friend, enough to give his son for you. Wow. I'm telling you again, friend, I don't love you that much. Any one of my 3 daughters or my grandchildren, I'm sorry. I might love you enough to die for you myself, maybe. But don't think that I love you enough to give one of my children or grandchildren for you. I'm sorry. I'll just go ahead and have the big one and follow Fred Sanford up there. It's me. I'm coming, Lord. You know, I ain't going to give one of my children for you. I'm sorry. But God loved Darryl Quinn that much. God loved you, and I could go all the way around this room and name you one by one and name every single one of you individually face to face and tell you God loves you so much he gave his son to die for you. Whoa. And here the Apostle Paul is showing his heart. Now he's a special servant of God, and he had this special anointing from God, and he loved folks, and his ministry was primarily to Gentiles. That's where he was sent to minister there, but he still had a heart that was burning. It was heavy. It was filled with sorrow because he loved his own Jewish friend, and they were saying no to God, just like many in our churches. They have the right words, but not the right heart. It's not there. Now let me show you something. Here in chapter 9, the Apostle Paul goes ahead and his talk about his kinfolk, the Jews, the Israelites. He begins to show us that they should have long ago accepted Christ, but they rejected Christ instead. Look there, if you would, verse 4 in Romans chapter 9. Now Paul is just saying, "I love my brethren, my kinsmen. I love them." And then he describes them in verses 4 and 5. And right here is where we see how blessed the Israelites were and are. They still are today. Now, notice it says, they are Israelites. You know, right there, you can stop. You know what that means? Like, some of you in here probably say, they're Appling County Pirates. They're Georgia Crackers. Any Bulldogs in the room? Nope, no, don't want to get that started. This is a thing that whenever Paul said these folks are Israelites, just by saying that word, he singled them out from everybody else in the world. You know, you could talk about Egyptians or Philistines or Amalekites or whoever in that day and time. But these were Israelites. They were special. They were very special. You know, it's kind of like, have you ever met, I'm sure it's not you and your family, but have you ever met one of those families? I saw this. I was loading up a bunch of kids to leave off on a youth retreat. Had a teenage girl and her two brothers were loading up on the bus with us. And I'll never forget the dad walking up to them just outside the door of the bus. Now, don't forget who you are. That was his last words. Don't forget who you are. Now, the truth is, he done learned their family name. And I mean big time. But he was telling his youngins, don't you forget who you are. Like he was proud of the name that he had that he was passing on to his children. He's proud of that name, yeah. And I started to turn around and said, you know, but I didn't. You know, I was polite and proper. But wait a minute, that attitude seems to prevail a lot of times. And here what Paul is doing is he realized these are Israelites. That name, that meant through history in the Middle East, the term Israelite carried a significant meaning. Oh, sometimes they were belittled and mocked and made fun of, but in the end, in every case, in the end, wind up, God would come back down and boom, somebody gonna get a whooping. Yeah. And he did it because they were Israelites. Now hold on. Not only does he say there in this verse of scripture, they are Israelites to whom pertaineth the adoption. They were adopted. We mentioned that a while ago. It's back in Romans chapter 8. We are adopted into the family of God. The Israelites have been adopted as the family of God. Now, hold on. I do not have an answer for this. I do not know why. It's God and his choosing, his choice. The Israelites were chosen by God to be the nation he was going to bless and use all through the history of mankind, even to this day. The Israelites, and it's God's choosing. He adopted the Israelites as a nation. As a nation, he said, you are my people. I have chosen you. And he blessed them. He protected them. He guided them. Now, there were times when they rebelled and did wrong, and he had to whip them. But they were his, just like a good father or a good mother oftentimes has to spank their own child. And that spanking, that whipping that God put on the Israelites was for their own good. And so he's saying here, you have been adopted. Now, Paul's talking about his brethren, talking about himself. We are Israelites. We've been adopted. Yeah, yeah. Well, it goes on and it says, and not only do they have the name Israelites, they have been adopted, but it says they have the glory. You know, I got to be honest, I read that. They got the glory. They got the glory. Ah, first terminology I think about for Darrell Quinn is, man, it was glorious whenever they whooped them Egyptians and left town. But all of God's power, all those plagues, all that might from God that was revealed on the Egyptians, how God took all those gods of the Egyptians and he made fun of them and mocked them and stomped them in the ground, literally, right on down to the very son of the Pharaoh himself. And God proved he was God. And his word glory, I'm thinking about it, and I'm thinking, yeah, man, that's where God got the glory. Whenever he provided that protection for those Jews and brought them out of bondage and led them across that Red Sea, man, what a story. That's glorious to me. But I did my reading, and I try to follow behind folks smarter than me. And one of them said, no, that's not where he's talking about here when it says glory. When it says they had the glory, it wasn't the power with which God delivered them. Y'all remember the Shekinah glory? Some of y'all remember that word? Shekinah glory. The Israelites had that as a special gift to them. The Shekinah glory is the glory of God. When God came down on the mountaintop with Moses, and that mountaintop looked like it was on fire. There was lightning flashing and thunder rolling, and there was smoke billowing up, and there was something going on. It was God and his Shekinah glory. And you remember while they were in the wilderness, during the day there was a cloud that the Jews would follow. Have y'all ever walked around out here? It's about 20 miles from right out here to the nuclear plant. Y'all ever been right out here in this area and look over there and you see sometimes when there ain't no clouds in the sky, but there'll be a little pillar of a cloud coming up way over yonder north of Baxley. Y'all see? Hello. I know I'm not the only one that's seen that. 20 miles away. And we're watching that mist or fog or smoke or whatever you want to call it rise from the nuclear plant out yonder 20 miles away. I got a tip for you. For the Israelites, when there was thousands, hundreds of thousands, some say even millions of people in that family that was wandering through the wilderness, there in the front of them, I don't know how many miles it was from the last guy in the caravan to the guys in the front, but out there in the front, miles and miles away, there was the glory of God rising up in the clouds. It was God's glory that was there. At night, it was a glory of fire, a pillar of fire. Bright and shining. You know, it's kind of like what we see on a sunset or a sunrise, and we see the glory of the sun on the other side coming through, and that cloud lights up with strange and beautiful lights in there. That glory, now that's what it says here. Now, Paul's reminding everybody, this is who the Israelites are. They are the ones who have the name Israelite. They're the ones who have been adopted into the family. They're the ones who have the power of God's glory there to lead them in these Israelites. Oh, man. But it doesn't stop there. It says, and they have the covenants. The Jewish people, the Israelites, are the ones who had the covenants. Now, that's like a contract. And I have met those folks who are part of the church who said they didn't want nothing to do with no covenants. They didn't want to make no promises. Won't make no pledges. Well, you got a problem, because our God's all about it. From Genesis to Revelations, He's all about it. And if you're not willing to make a promise or a covenant with God, you really got a problem. But here, what we're seeing in the Apostle Paul's teaching is that the Israelite nation is the nation, the group of people that God chose to make special covenants with. There was the covenant of Abraham, the covenant of David. Saturday was a special day. It's going to be a special sign between the Jews and God. Circumcision was a special sign between the Jews and God. There's different ways in which God established covenants with the Israelite people. And He said, you're my people. We're going to enter into a covenant together. And the Jews had that. And they were blessed with that. But not only did they have the covenants, but it also says, and they are the ones that the giving of the law was done. You know, Moses on the mountain, Ten Commandments. You realize in this world today, even today, in the midst of the ungodliness and the anti-biblical stuff that's going on all over the world, do you realize the Ten Commandments are the basics of every civilized nation in the world, period. Every nation that has decency about them, they go back to the giving of the law, the commandments. You know, maybe not the first four, but those last six definitely. You know, they're part all over the world. People realize that's just laws that are good. That's just commandments that are good. And it's worldwide. It's known. And so here Apostle Paul is making known, say, you, the Israelites, are the ones that God gave those laws to through Moses and those Ten Commandments. But now, it doesn't stop there. He's going on. He says, not only are you the ones who are Israelites, you've been adopted, you have the glory, you have the covenant, you got the law, but look at this next phrase. You got the service of God. Oh, that's an ugly word, ain't it? Service. That's kind of like work, ain't it? We're going to serve somebody? We're going to be involved in a service? We got not a 11 o'clock meeting now, you understand? The serving. You know what he's talking about? It was the Israelite people who were declared to be the priest of God. The priests who were in charge of the tabernacle and the church, if you will, the temple. It's the Israelite people who have been given the commands from God to minister, to serve in that capacity and minister to all the other folk. And so we see these Israelites have been given that privilege. Not only that, but they also, according to the last phrase there in verse 4 in Romans 9, says, and you've been given the promises, the promises. That a Messiah is coming. The promise. That there will be a time when this Messiah rules on earth as Lord of lords and King of kings. and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. And to the Israelite people, those promises were made. It's coming. There's going to be a time when it happens. The promises. Now, we could go into a lot of other promises that God gave to the Israelites about protection and provision and stuff like that. But wow, it's the promises that are there. The promise. Now, look at verse 5 when it starts. I've got two here in verse 5. It says, and whose are the fathers? The Israelites are the ones who have the right, properly, theologically, literally, bloodline-wise, to declare the fathers are theirs. You know, like the little song, Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham, and I'm one of them. Well, the Israelites could declare that to be true more effectively and truthfully than anybody else in the world, period. As a matter of fact, he goes into some detail, Paul does here in the next few verses of Scripture. You can read that this afternoon sometime and see how he talks about how that it's the promises of God concerning their fathers. You know, any of y'all like to claim your fathers? Maybe not your dad, but beyond your dad, your grandfather, great-grandfather. You like to check out your lineage. Maybe you've gone on and looked for one of them leaves that the TV talks about, to see who you connected to. I ain't never done that. My mama done that, and she gave me the book, so I can just read the book. But all this kind of stuff, I don't never get you. I'm going to be honest with you. I like knowing who I hate to say this. According to my mama's research, if I can trust my mama, I had folks who had fought for the king and folks with George Washington. I'm both sides. I don't know where to be happy or sad or just, you know, whatever. But I'm here to tell you something. Who's our fathers? I'm going to be real plain with you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord, for the forefathers of the United States of America and what they said, what they believed, where they stood, and what they were willing to die for. And unfortunately, we were living in a time when more folks are worried about, well, me and mine, am I going to make it? Will I be all right? I don't want to cause no waves. Don't want to ruffle no feathers. Kind of like I heard about the guy, the preacher, got through preaching. He must have been fired up and walked outside. And one of the men looked at him and said, brother, kind of rubbing the cat the wrong way, ain't you? And that preacher looked at him and said, then the cat ought to turn around. I'm going to tell you something, folks. There comes a time when you hear and see what's going on around us and folks start telling us that we cannot be. Yesterday morning, somebody was telling me that they had heard this week that in California they had started passing some laws about Christians can only witness to other members of their church. Nah. My Jesus said, go into the highways and byways of the world and compel them to come in. Now, who are we going to obey? Some guy that sits in a building and thinks he's a hot shot? Or God? I'm here to tell you, friend, you choose to obey the hot shot in the White House or the hot shot in the governor's house or wherever they are instead of obeying God, and wrath will come your way. Here it comes. Who are you going to obey? You see, Paul is pointing out that the Israelites had all these blessings, all these things that happened to them, from just being Israelites to being adopted to all this other stuff that we've just looked at. But you know what happened? They said, they chose not to accept Christ. They chose not to follow God. It was their choice. Now, Jesus makes it plain. I know a lot of folks have different opinions about how we should act and treat, and folks want us to be nice and quiet and sweet and humble and polite and proper and all that kind of stuff. I guess you just don't want no Darryl Quinn. But I'm here to tell you something. I'm going to follow Jesus. And Jesus said, there's coming a day when the people are going to come to him and they're going to cry out, Lord, Lord, have we not done great things for you? Have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not preached your name, Lord? And Jesus said he's going to look at them and he's going to say, I'm sorry. I never knew you. Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Wait a minute. Did you see what Jesus said? There's going to be preachers in the bunch. Preachers that's going to bust hell wide open because they never got right with Jesus. People who actually did amazing, wonderful works for God. Maybe they were tithers or givers or workers at the church or did missionary work and fed folks at where they were cold and hungry and all that kind of stuff. But I'm here to tell you, none of that gets you into heaven. None of it. You'll come the way Jesus says come, or you'll go to a lake of fire. It's your choice. Do you understand? The Apostle Paul has reached a point in this writing of the book of Romans that he's come to the place where his heart is broken and he's looking around and he's thinking about his Jewish brethren, his kinfolk, and he loves his kinfolk and he wishes his kinfolk could get saved. He wishes he could see them in heaven. He wishes they'd be a part of the family of God, but he knows they've had all these benefits, all these blessings, and God's dealt with them so wonderfully for thousands of years, and still they say no. Before you get too hard on them, you know how many folks are in the church that are saying no? They're all around us. They're all around us. It's your choice. Jesus loves you. He died for you. But the choice is yours. Does he know? Once again, I'll share it with you. I rejoice over this. During our vacation Bible school, and Steve Benet and I had talked pointedly. He had a real heart for our boys and girls. And he didn't want to talk them into doing something that he shouldn't talk them into. And he talked to me plainly about how, Brother Darryl, I don't want these kids to be raising their hands or praying prayers or making decisions just because I talk them into it. I said, I appreciate that. And then that Wednesday night when he stood up right down here and he went through the plan of salvation with these boys and girls and just simply told them what Jesus had done for them and how that he died for them. And he didn't say you need to or you ought to or you should. He never said those words. He just said, how many of y'all would like to accept Jesus as your Savior? 21 hands went up. Stephen, I could see the look on his face. He was he knew that he didn't want these kids to be doing it just because he was telling them they should, and he was trying to make sure he didn't say anything wrong. And he looked at me, and I was sitting over on this side. I said, it's okay. And he said, if you're serious, would you please stand? And the 21 boys and girls stood up. And he said, okay, y'all follow Brother Darryl. And I went through here with four or five adults, and we went into the social hall. 21 boys and girls sitting around. I had them all sit down around one set of tables. And looking at him, I don't know how to say this. Sometimes I am a preacher. I do stand in front of people a pretty good bit. I can tell when somebody's with me and when you ain't. Oh, yes, I can. Not just when your eyes are closed. Sorry. I was amazed. I'm serious. When I stood in there and I looked in 21 sweet little faces
And they were sitting around the table, and they were bending over to make sure they could see me. They were all looking up at me. I think, Lord, help me. And I simply, as briefly as I could, sincerely, properly, told them they need to pray and ask Jesus Christ to forgive them and be their Savior. If they knew who he was and what he did, and they wanted to do that. And they all said they wanted to. Had them stand up, and we held hands around in a circle. I said, now I want y'all to pray with me. I don't want you just to pray this prayer in your heart. I know you can be saved. I really believe you can genuinely be saved if you pray the prayer in your heart, but I don't like doing that. I'm sorry. I want you to say it. I want to hear you say it. I want to know you said it. I said, I want y'all to pray with me right out loud. And I started into it, and I had my head bowed. And I looked around at my little boys and girls. And I said, dear Lord Jesus, whew, all around the room, dear Lord Jesus. That was good. They finished the prayer and asked Christ to forgive them for their sins and be their saviors. Woo! Glory! Hey, sometimes you ought to get a little Holy Ghost in you, friend. It's okay to every once in a while get excited about the things of Jesus. As a matter of fact, Titus 2:14 says it this way. He gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquitous sin and purify unto himself a peculiar people. And that word does mean better than the rest. I'm sorry. Some of you think, are you holier than thou? You holy Joe? You? I don't care what you want to call it. Friend, just call me saved. Headed to glory. And you're going to bust hell wide open. Just do it any way you want to. But here it is. Here it is. Titus 2:14 winds up when it says, talking about a peculiar people. And he winds up Titus 2:14 by saying, who are zealous of good works. That's right. God's word says you ought to get excited every now and then about something other than Georgia Bulldogs. You ought to get excited every now and then about the work of God. And in this world in which we're living, whenever you see the devil doing his dirty, deadly work and literally killing people right and left around the world, if you can't get excited about God doing a little work every here and there, you've got a problem. And I don't really know how to solve it. You just need to get saved. Excited? Does Jesus excite you? He should. May you not be like the Israelites who said, no, no. Please say yes. Yes, Lord. Next Sunday night, I'm gonna do something I ain't done since last year. I'm going to climb all them steps around here. I've been kind of dreading that. I'm getting better. I'm thinking I'm going to get up there and stay a while before I come down. But I'm going to tell you something. If you haven't settled that issue, if you're just going around and say, I hope I make it. You know, I'm doing the best I can. Well, you know, I try. Well, we good folk. Everybody tell you I'm a good neighbor, and you'll burn in hell if that's all you got. Because if the shed blood of Calvary's cross hasn't washed your sins away, you ain't got it. What about it? What do you need to settle? Please, don't let Paul's heavy, broken heart be in vain. Let's pray. Lord, in this room, all kinds of needs. And Lord, I know I can't meet them. I know I'm not smart enough. I'm not good enough. But Lord, I know you. Hallelujah. I know you're the awesome God, and you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all that we can ask or even think. Thank you, Lord. And I'm asking God that you touch all our hearts, every person in this room. Help us to humble ourselves before you. May you deal with our hearts as you see fit. For your glory. And then I know it'll be for our good. It's in Jesus' name I pray.